Welcome to tonight's program with Dr. Grantley Walrond.
I remember well in 1963 when I heard of the assassination of Dr. John Kennedy. I remember exactly what I was doing as a youngster.
Something important must have happened on June 13, 1980.
Something significant indeed, because many of us who received the news in shock silence remember mundane things that we were doing, and we heard of what happened on that fateful evening. And it was regarded to the Geological Survey of the Mines Department that evening when I left work late, who said to me, "Doc, you know what happened? Rupert gets murdered." Since then, 25 years later, much work has gone, understandably, under the bridge. You can be certain that there was much speculation about who was Walter Rodney. What did he represent? Why did he die the way he did? What legacy has he left us? Can we extrapolate his views to help us in our current circumstances? Was Walter Rodney one of Diana's virtuous sons, or was he a villainous adventurer? To assist us with this exploration this evening are persons who knew Walter Rodney well.
They are Dr. Rupert Roopnarine, leader of the Working People's Alliance, Dr. David Hinds, executive member of the Working People's Alliance, and Miss Jocelyn Dow, who prefers to simply be called concerned citizen and a friend of Walter Rodney. Gentlemen, ladies, welcome to Spotlight. In the first place, you're all part of a committee which is dubbed the Walter Rodney 25th Anniversary Commemoration Committee, which wishes to call the celebration of Walter Rodney and his vision of emancipation, quote unquote. Tell me, why in 2005 we should be taking time out to join you in this exercise?
Well, I think that we are, not only here in Guyana, but in the region and further afield, I would say that we are all as citizens of the world, much in need of as much inspiration as we can find to cope with what this faces us. I think we are faced today in Guyana, in the region and in the wider world, with challenges which are enormous. And I think that Walter Rodney's ability to cope with enormous inspiration and point of ideas, which can assist us in making sense of the world in which we live, and which I think can encourage us to fight for a better world, because the theme of the country, the theme of the groundings this year is another world of necessary. And we feel, when we look at the world perfectly, whether we are talking about the extremely unjust international economic arrangements, or whether we are talking about the fairly degenerate state in which we are in the Caribbean, especially if we're talking about all the fractured conditions in Guyana, I think that it is not difficult to agree that we need to fight for a better world, we need to fight for a world in which there is going to be more justice, more equity, where we need to demand for the various forms of oppression that we treat ourselves today. And it is in this context that we find Walter Rodney's work, his life, his example, as tremendous inspiration. And if it's for that reason, I think that as many people as can possibly do so should join us in the various gatherings that we're holding. We're hoping to make the program widely known. We're holding gatherings in Lingang, in Northeast at the same campus, on the Ethical Coast, on the West Coast, on the East Coast, and of course here in Georgetown, where most of the activities will be at the ECU Hall in Wilson Avenue, remembering Walter as a teacher. So I would say that, you know, there are all these activities happening. We have close to 7,400 international guests who are coming. Many of them former colleagues of Walter's, coming from as far as Africa, the United States, the region. And we're hoping that we can have, over this recent doing, events that not only remember Walter and his work and his passion, but which can leave us at the end of the story with some more, you know, ammunition and some more energy to carry on.
Any comments, David and or Jocelyn? And
well,
why do you think, apart from what Rupert has indicated?
But just to reinforce what Rupert said, a number of the problems that we face today in Guyana, in the Caribbean, the rest of the world, among working people all over the world, a lot of those problems were problems that Walter grappled with and spent a lot of energy on. And a lot of those issues are unresolved. Certainly things present themselves differently, so that we don't talk today so much about poverty and so forth. We talk about globalization and all that kind of thing. So, you know, there's been a lot of change in the names and so on. But really the face of the naked oppression of ordinary people throughout the world has remained. And so therefore, the fact that Walter spent a lot of energies on those issues means that his work is unfinished. And so therefore he is, of course, relevant as we look towards dealing with those problems. And in that regard, he is as fresh today as he was 30, 40 years ago.
Yeah,
that's
good. Yeah, of course. I mean, Walter inspired me. And that's a very, I think, ordinary reason that has to do with the justice. His family is coming home for the first time as a whole. His son came when he did his fast and vigil for Gregory Smith's return. But, you know, Walter was a historian, he was a great political activist, but he was a person who was our friend, and who was a father to these children and a husband. And Guyanese, I think, have an obligation to remember all of the important figures of our past. And it worries me deeply that every generation of new leaders almost forgets the past. Whether you think they were villainous adventurers or virtuous sons, there is no doubt to me that he was a great virtuous son, perhaps the most virtuous son of this country. And I think that, certainly for me, it is important that for his family, that this is a closure of a certain sort. Reggie Smith has died, there will be no justice at that end. You can have an international inquiry, which we hope we will have. But it is, to me, very important that those Guyanese, like you, I remember exactly what I was doing, and I frankly don't know anyone who is still sharp in their mind what they were doing on that night, that Friday, June 30th, at the time when the news of his death spread around this town and this country and internationally. And therefore, to me, this is the beginning of a very ordinary path of decency and closure on this matter as well. And I think the other things that both Rupert and David have said, things that have to do with reminding us that, you know, there were great figures of our past, not only Walter, but going further back, and the great struggles of our forebears, it's very relevant here, because I think we have to remake our society, try to heal all of these things, and I think it's a personal thing. I wish we were celebrating not the anniversary of his death, but of his life.
You know, it is true from the paraphernalia you've put out thus far on this event, that you are, in fact, celebrating as an Walter Rodney as an internationalist. As Rupert indicated, friends and friends, whether in his lifetime or men who have become his friends through the work that he performed, they will be joining you. I would wish, however, since we are closer to home, to ask you to help define for us what the objective conditions, the socio-political economic conditions, were like in Walter's day. For instance, if you would, just repatriate Walter home to Guyana and describe for us the objective conditions of that day, so that we may understand what caused Walter Rodney to be Walter Rodney.
Let me say first of all that Walter had not come back to this country, as I had not, during the earlier period of communist strife. He did not come here in the 60s. He left the country and went off to, to the United States in Jamaica, went off to Tanzania, and came back really at the middle of the 70s, 73, 74, at the time when Walter was entering the country. So he missed that extreme traumatic period in our own nation's history. And he was written somewhere that, he didn't come back during that period because, given the state of the country and the sharp division among the working people and the way in which its society was polarized, he did not see what role he could possibly play in a situation like that. And in a real sense, when he came back in around 74, there were things happening to him. The first thing that happened, of course, was that by 1968, Mr. Burnham, who was the Prime Minister, jettisoned his coalition partner of 1964, whom he went into independence. And from 1968, the rigging of the elections really began. And in 1973, you may recall, it was the year of the great breakthrough, when Mr. Burnham came that he had defeated the PPP and the quarantine and various other things. And it was really a response to the events of 73 and those particular elections that the various meetings that formed the Working People's Alliance came together to establish the pre-party WPA, which was then formed by Asprey and Kitra and the Working People's Vanguard Party, and so on. At this time, Walter had been appointed Professor of History at the University of Guyana. And of course, the story is well known. He was denied appointment at the university. And great mobilization began to take place in that period. And the most remarkable thing is that UC Guyana and Kerry Zeven, who had been, of course, comrades in the anti-colonial struggles of the 1950s, had not appeared in public together since the split of the PPP in the 1950s, 1957. And for the very first time in the meetings that were held to protest Rodney's banning from the University of Guyana, UC Guyana and Kerry Zeven appeared for the very first time on the political platform in this country in the modern period since the anti-colonial revolution. And this has come to me to say in the past that Walter was in effect a force for unity of the movement even before he set his foot in Guyana. And the period you're describing, of course, 73 to 78, when we had the referendum that imposed the 1980 constitution eventually on us, this was a period of considerable turbulence. Turbulence in terms of the... I arrived back here in 1977, for instance, and arrived in the middle of the 135-day sugar strike. At that time, this was the period of the Arnold Rampersad trial, in which Walter was an extraordinary public advocate on the street up and down the country, literally talking himself hoarse to ensure that Arnold Rampersad got a fair trial. It was the period of the Beijing trial. It was a period of considerable upheaval, and the forces gathering the argument for a return to constitutional government, the people's right to elect a government of their own choice, which had been denied since 1968. It was, in fact, gathering momentum. And by the time the referendum came to be imposed in 1978, I would say that the popular forces were in the ascendancy, fully mobilized. There was the sugar strike of 1977, the Rodney's trials I mentioned, there was a referendum in 1978, and of course, on the anniversary of the referendum, in 1979, on July 10th, it was the the evening of the great fire in Camp Street, where the office of the General Secretary and the Minister of National Mobilization burned to the ground. This was followed by the arrests of WPA leaders, including Walter, myself, Vanessa Harris, Karen Sue, the former Patra, and so on. And that event really triggered what came to be called the Civil Rebellion of that period. I mean, the Civil Rebellion, largely led by Walter as an enormously charismatic popular leader. We're talking about a situation here, Grantley, which is difficult for those who at the present time to imagine. That political meetings, that what was Border Mall, as you call it, the Walter Rodney Mall, which was, would attract, you know, 20,000, 15,000 people. People have not seen anything like it since the anti-colonial mobilization of the 1950s. And it was a very, very, to my mind, as I said, a period of extraordinary turbulence, extraordinary energy, extraordinary creativity at that time. And unfortunately, the momentum that was building, and which I think was seen as by the rulers, at the time, it was very threatening. That momentum came to an end in a very serious way after the assassination. He was assassinated on June 13th of 1918, and this emboldened Mr. Burnham at the time to go ahead and hold the elections on December 1918, when we in WPA had our first major dispute with our allies in the democratic struggle with DPP, because we argued in 1918 that really what we ought to be doing is remain on the streets and try to rebuild the momentum of the mass movement in the streets and not participate in another election of the kind that we were having. And we could not get the people who were really participating in the elections in 1918. We boycotted the elections in 1918. And that was one of the periods of great strain between the Democratic Allies in the period. So I would say that Walter came back here at the time when not only Guyana, but the region was in a state of some upheaval and turbulence. Remember that, you know, the Grenada Revolution had happened, the NGM was in power, the Sandinistas had got the rhythm of the Somoza, the Shah had been dealt with in Iran, and really, the, you know, the winds of freedom were really gusting around the world, and we and Guyana felt that, you know, we should be part of this general worldwide and regional movement, and the struggle at that time defined fairly narrowly as a struggle for bread and justice. I mean, Clyde Thomas's was a seminal paper in that period, bread and justice, where he argued that you really could not get economic development without bread and justice and democracy.
You reminded us of that last week.
Right. And that was one of the founding documents of the Liberty. And we, as I say, it was a period that galvanized the energies and so on of a lot of people. You know, it was a big exodus of a lot of people after the assassination. Because I remember in that period they had been a grouping among the middle stratum of the compass group that had gotten together and were speaking with them, and they were putting forward bold ideas at the time. So I think that he came back and found the situation ready for him in a real sense. And of course contributed to it as no one else could have done. And he turned what could have been sporadic protests here and there into a real mass movement in Guyana, the like of which we have not seen yet.
Any additions?
No. Two things I wanted to note. In 1974, the PNC declared paramountcy of the party in a document called Declaration of Sofia, which, for all intents and purposes, closed the door, slammed the door on any hope that the Guyanese people have for democratic change. They're taking 10 years to consolidate power and to move from the authoritarian state that was left by the colonials to a post-colonial authoritarian state, Stamford Bonaventure, and paramount of the party, which meant that all states entities were subjected to the dictates of the party. So we had the PNC flag, for example, being flown over the Court of Appeal. And so it was in those conditions, there was a finality, if you will, in terms of democratic change. There was also something else that was going on in the society, quietly, but as started. That is in 1973. UC Guyana had broken with the PNC publicly in 1971 and challenged the PNC on the issue of corruption. That was a defining moment, because what followed was the UC Guyana and ASCRE joining up with IPRA to mount the landless campaign in 1973. It's a little moment in our history that sometimes we tend to overlook, but that was the first small demonstration of Indian-African solidarity, where ordinary Indians and Africans squatted on lands that were being vacated by the sugar companies and so forth. And the PNC, of course, moved in and sent in the army and got rid of that. But so Rodney was coming in 74 when the rudiments of the multiracial struggle were being planted. And of course, the government had closed the door on democratic change. So Rupert is on the ball when he said the situation was tailor-made for Rodney. And he just had the capacity. Someone said, you know, he was in him, we had what was time and place, the right time and the right place meeting in this port. And so he was able to take that and really take it tremendous. That's so that by 1980, when he was assassinated, people in Guyana felt that they were almost there in terms of creating this new world that we are talking about during this grounding. That Walter Rodney, I remember as a youngster, as a teenager, Walter Rodney made me personally, a number of us in my generation, felt that another world was possible. And so as 15, 16-year-olds, we joined that movement, in spite of our parents being a little bit skeptical of us getting into politics, because it convinced us that another world was possible. And very importantly, that we could help to shape that world. And for me personally, that was very defining. Okay.
And I think, for somebody like myself, I had come from a fairly apolitical background, you know, you understood civic service. My father and my family were involved in that. But I was inspired by that whole period to really, in a sense, throw my lot in with that fight for bread and justice, for a democratic society. And it was a curious time, if you recall, because there was also the paradox. So Guyana was doing all sorts of things. We were nationalizing sugar. We nationalized bauxite. Yes, and we had begun to deal with what was our own, defining art, our own defining ethos, so to speak. And this was going on at the same time as this other discomfort was there about the whole question of whether this had to be at the cost of rigged elections. So for, I think, the middle class in particular, what Walter did was really sharpen their lens on that dichotomy, you know. And I could remember, like, my aunts and uncles and, you know, of that ilk, slowly coming from the idea that this was just, you know, another kind of new and wild movement, to a deep love and affection for Walter and for what he was attempting to do. And because he used our history, our own history, and the world's history at the same time to really draw the lessons. The things that happened on the mall, those enormous occasions with thousands of people and police and riot squad and so on, it was the way in which he drew on our own past to really explain some of the contradictions of the present. And I think that is what inspired another kind of, another set of Guyanese, another kind of energy, because, you know, the kind of non-trust feeling that many of us had, who were both proud of a certain part of what Guyana was doing, but, you know, horrified by the cost it had. You know, I myself was at school in the 60s, you know, and living in Georgetown when it was burning down. So there were a lot of things in your own formation that had not been clarified by the paramount political situation, whether it was the DPR or PNC in a sense, that Walter did. He really ignited a new understanding for our generation.
I mean, all of us have alluded, of course, to these tremendous public meetings that Walter had, where there were really vast numbers of people and so on. But I remember the very first public meeting I heard him speak at was at Border Market. Not by the mall, but somewhere in the core two districts. There were really not very many people, maybe 50 or 60 people. And Walter was really quietly teaching them things. And he wrapped attention of these people listening. It wasn't a revolutionary call to action. It was fairly pedagogic, but it was really in his own manner. It was always comprehensible, simple, making very complex ideas quite digestible to ordinary people. And we mustn't forget the kind of work that he was doing in Britain at the time. He was up there, he and Kai Thomas were teaching history and political economy, the small groups, the bus-type workers. So there was a lot of that kind of work also going on. So when the time came that there was what was something called the Great Ignition, and you had all of these people, it had a basis in that very quiet work that was done for a period of time among working people. And I think that that is something, something of tradition in WTA, which was really established by Clive and Walter. That responsibility, not just to go in there and mobilize people for the action, but to go in there and really try to, clarify things and lift people together to understanding of the world in which they are living, what it is shaping that world, what it is that is, help them to make sense of what we're having difficult lives.
You know, all three of you, knowingly or otherwise, you talked about the environment which I invited you to talk about, being prepared, as it were, for the coming of Walter. I mean, I hate to make it, to put it in those terms. But one of the things that is quite clear is that the WTA, which Walter... was full of academics. Mm-hmm. Walter perhaps was the greatest, Yusikawara was clearly an activist, academic activist for a long, long time, but Walter was the principal. Wherever he went, activism seems to have followed him. Jamaica, Tanzania, clearly Guyana, where ultimately his end came. What it is about the WPA which Walter Rodney led, and so many academics, to which so many academics were drawn, who became activists, and this is, it's a major distinction that must be made here, because in a general sense, most academics do not become activists.
You also have some activists who became academics. We have some more preparing right now.
What it is about the seeming inability of the WTA to attract electoral votes over the years that we could learn with from the standpoint of the model which we saw develop with this group of academics who presumably were able to think it through, move to activism, try to make a change, but yet not seemingly being able to capture the public imagination. What it is? What lessons are we learning here?
If I can start off here, rather than that. I think that you have to remember that the WP of Walter Rodney was never tested in any lecture. That's the first thing.
That's correct.
So it's very hard. Well, we have surmised that whether they would have broken, in the end, broken the racial tightness and ethnic base of Guyana. On all appearances, it was peaceful. If you had had an election, I believe, in those days, I think that hands down, you would have had a change in the way in which voting in from blacks have voted in this country. But that's really speculation, because it was untested. But I can say to you that what was, you know, I think when you said that we all speak of this, the time for this great person to have come, it's because in all of us there's a certain pride and fondness that every time you see, listen to any of us speak about Walter, that is what is emanating. You know, that this was somebody who inspired us. And we were his friends. It's very hard for you to inspire your friends, right? But he did inspire us. Because the Walter that you fretted with before you left for the public meeting was not the Walter who you responded to when he was on the platform. You know, because when he was speaking, no matter how close you were to him, you were inspired. And I think that that was, to me, it's always, I was born in the 50s, right? So I mean, it always strikes me that what you heard about, how people describe that 50s movement, is something, a quality of that was caught up in this period. That sense of a society that felt ready for the challenge, to make itself, to stamp itself on the world. That was very much the feeling I had, you know, as a person whose political consciousness of your near 20s were, in 1980, that is what it felt. That this, you were ready to take on the world, to make your mark, to do your bit against oppression, to throw your hand in with this movement. And I think that after that brutal kind of rupture, that to me, I mean, people abused us for all sorts of things, why we didn't respond, why we didn't, you know, burn down the town, why we didn't do all sorts of things. But I think that it was like a terrible hurt for the society, and things not only went back to normal, people kind of were now, had terrible emotional barriers about venturing again. You know, they had really ventured with water, and a lot of people across all classes, I think, felt a kind of pain and a sense of despair that, you know, it doesn't matter what you do. This thing is, the die is cast in this particular direction. And I think that's the name.
The other point I wanted to make, I wanted to make very quickly about the WPA, and you call them academics, but because the thing is them intellectuals. If you think of the national movement, out of which it is, the national movement between 1950 and 2000 essentially was split into three factions, not two. Because when the Sipayana and the quote-unquote out-elected were expelled from the party, what we effectively had was three factions, one which was led by Paul Verlaine. And I'm not going to get into call that the social democratic faction, if you like. One, you know, faction led by Jeremy. And you had this kind of, you know, romantic, ultra-leftist, artistic faction, which was grouped around people like Fran and Rodney. Now, the remarkable thing is that the 1985, before Mr. Burnham died, you had the three political parties, the PMC, the PPP, and the WPA. And essentially, it was being led by these four people who had led the faction of this interesting, because in effect, they were the three factions of the original national movement. And part of what I think Kelly, in his later years, Walter, myself, one of the things we feel very committed to, in fact, it's really constitutional to that movement. It's not put in these terms when it's being discussed for many years, governance or shared governance or whatever it is. It's got to be
that. So what's that notion of vulgarity?
I don't mean that.
I don't know.
But in effect, what we're talking about is really the reconstitution of a natural movement that was at one time whole and integrated. The interesting thing about that, to my mind, is that this intellectual romantic faction, the one with the artists and the poets and the thinkers and the animal groups, effectively that is what formed and inspired it as it is. So it had from its very origin an attitude to intellectuals and artists and writers and that kind of thing. And there's some political parties that are more applicable to that kind of deviance than others. I mean, as I said, I want to be harsh on the two major parties of the country, but I want to say that the WTA is the one I know best. It has always been, as I say, extremely hospitable for people working in those areas of science or history or poetry or all, you know, that's really comforting. And if you ask me the other harder question, which is why we have not ever done well electorally, I can give you part of the answer. I think that for as long as the country remains polarized, and for as long as the ethnic insecurity remains at the level that it is, and what we know about an election period, is that the ethnic insecurity rises to really virtually uncontrollable level, that for as long as this is present in the body politic and among the people, I do not believe that WTO can ever grow and thrive. For as long as that's the case, actually. Because if you examine our patterns, and I have major disagreements with, you know, someone I respect and work with very closely, my friend Anthony Paris, who does not accept this call. But if you accept, as I do, that the pattern of voting since the polarization of the country in the 1970s period, that the pattern of voting has remained to a large extent, I'm not saying there hasn't been crossover votes, done, but by the time enough crossover votes crossed over, we will all be, you know, dead and our grandchildren will be voting. But the fact of the matter is the broad masses have continued to vote in that particular way. And as I say, if the ethical security rises and these voting patterns remain the same, I don't believe that parties other than these two main groups representing these two polarized sections of the community can ever thrive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, in the Rodney period, we didn't talk about elections. We talked about changing people's material circumstances individually and collectively, about what kind of society we want to live in. As a young person, as a teenager, I saw in that a future for me and my generation. That was the kind of politics. I think that was the kind of politics that the WPA is best at. I don't think the WPA ever learned electoral politics. I mean, it participated in elections, but never learned electoral politics. Electoral politics is not about empowerment. It's not about mobilizing people for changing the circumstances themselves. Elections are about you vote for someone who will change your circumstances. The Rodneyism is about you participating in your own emancipation. Elections don't do that, and WPA therefore never learned to do that very well. So the question you ask really points to the complexity of politics in these parts, these ex-plantations, where there are two types of politics. There's the electoral politics, which is based on, you know, you elect leaders who will do it for you. And then there's the empowerment politics, which is that people are mobilized to fight for their own security. And Walter always would say to people, it resounded, that if someone fights for your freedom and win that freedom for you, then tomorrow they can come and say, give me back that freedom. But if you fight for your own freedom, you will hold on to it very dearly. And so therefore, the complexity that we come into contact with is something, as Rupert said, that we'll have to work through. My own view is that if we deal with the question of empowerment, if we give people a chance to have a stake in their own empowerment, in determining their own lives, both individually and collectively, then perhaps the attitude to electoral politics will change. But I think, first of all, we've got to deal with the empowerment issue. That is why Walter Rodney is so relevant to me, because electoral politics, we have reached a point where we can't go further. We've proved that elections are not going to move us forward. And I want to say one more thing. WTA does not do well in electoral politics. But Mr. Corbyn quotes the UC Guyana when he talks about the solution to the racial problem. You can't talk about economic movement here without referring to Clive Thomas and so on and so forth. So where the ideas of the WTA are always present, because the WTA is not talking about ideas for power, but ideas to solve problems and empower.
I think in modern parlance, it would be meaningful and effective participatory democracy, and as they call it now, inclusive democracy. And you know, one of the things about the present period the world over, and I think that is why Walter is so relevant to Africa and to the developing South, is that this is the issue, that electoral democracy has not delivered the goods in most of the world. And a part of what it is that this essential nature of power, as understood by electoral democracy, if you don't have other structures in place, and in our post-plantation societies, what structures do we have in place? Can you, if you want to close down a school board, can you go and speak to the PTA to stop and fight for it? And it was one of the issues that came up in the, what was the capacity of Thatcher to influence what happened in England versus Reagan, because there were other structures in place that had to do with state and federal and hometown. And in our societies, I think the Westminster model has really led to this, the majoritarian rule has led to this essential systemic exclusion. You know, we try to fix it by saying that elections is the answer. Clearly it's not, because at the end of the election, even those who are voted for the majority then feel completely excluded from day-to-day, or largely excluded from day-to-day. And if you look at what this whole new kind of, you know, market-led policies are trying to do in the wings, is to talk about these other forms of participation, usually only of the poor, and very limited areas. And I think that is the challenge that is going on in the whole question of what the 21st century is to look like. How is it you're going to translate what is all this, these ideas, these examples, these models that have been set, but none of them have been operationalized. And I can't think of any society, though there are many societies struggling with it, to deal with that. And perhaps South Africa is a good model of trying to deal with, where you set aside some worries to try and deal with what is a whole society and what you have to give up to have that. Mm-hmm. Because that's the point, that in order to have that, everybody has to give up something, and people have to share power, literally.
I tell you what, it's a good point on which to recognize our responses. But when we return, we are going to once again try to translate some of what we have learned here about the experience of the WTA and third forces when we return after recognizing our sponsors. The first segment, we were looking at the relevance of electoral politics as opposed to empowerment politics, as David reminded us. Now, and I couldn't help but think, even as you were making your comment and you were talking about the groundwork into which Rodney found himself, in which he was thrust, and where the momentum seemed to develop, there was a buzz. Clearly, I do remember that quite well. There is even now a buzz in this country, and it concerns what we all simply been referring to as the third force, no one knowing clearly what it means, what it represents. except that some names have been called, we don't even know who the actors are. Some have argued that third forces are a romantic distraction. I heard the word romantic being used explicitly, but not as a distraction. Away from the hard work required for bridge building and reconciliation in societies such as ours. Could you please comment on this notion of the third force, the Yards, the example, the WPA, whatever, and what it is, what is its relevance to the real politics of this country? Talk about the division and all of that.
Well, as you said, I mean, you introduced the problem by, first of all, indicating how difficult it is to define what that is at the present time. I think that the people involved are in the process now of defining themselves and so on, and I wouldn't want to be seen as trying to suggest that, you know, someone or other, there's something wrong with that. But until they define themselves and they know very clearly what this force is going to stand for, it's very difficult to have an attitude to it. The only attitude really that WPA can have then is the attitude you have to all new political formations. Our general attitude is to welcome them. We live in a society where, frankly, our political system, which is really designed to encourage the growth of small formations, in actual practice, discourages them. We have always greeted the arrival of new forces with a great deal of. If not enthusiasm, certainly welcome. That's the first point. The second point I want to make is this. One of the things that Walter brought to the movement, to the country, in the period in which he was active, was that he brought tremendous hope. I mean, when David described the effect Walter had on him and his generation, whether or not this new force can have anything like a similar impact on a generation that seems to me in much need of direction and in much need of hopefulness, because we are dealing with a situation, your own program with some of the young people, where the sense of hopelessness is very deep. The idea of futurelessness, which was a notion I was introduced to by my friend Rafa Jackson, who got it from some of the young people who talked about it. But this idea of futurelessness and hopelessness and so on. So frankly, anything that arises in the society that gives them hope and encourages people to believe in themselves and their capacity to change the situation is, to me, a very positive thing. Now, whether or not the third force, as it is defining itself, is going to be capable of engendering that kind of hope, making it real, giving it a real practice and a real project, remains to be seen. If it does, then frankly, you can only benefit. If it does not, it will be, you know, another project of where we attempt to make a difference and don't quite come up to mark. We don't know as yet where that will go. As far as the electoral politics is concerned, I mean, I think David put it extremely well. I mean, the point for the WP has always been that our energies really have to be directed into empowerment, and none of us, frankly, in that period, and even later on, thought particularly electorally. We're not really electorally minded in the WP, even now, although we're participating in a number of elections. I remember the first election we went into, which was in 1985, when Guyana went into Parliament. And the statement he issued when UC went into Parliament was that he was going into Parliament to plant the banner of Walter Rodney in the National Assembly. That was the statement made by the WP. And the idea there was that he would go there, make full use of the Parliament, but if you know Guyana, you must know that he was the apostle of empowerment even before Walter. I mean, his great belief in the self-organization of the village communities, people looking after their own business and so on, is deep of it. Of course, it also helped that many of us did not come out of electoral tradition. Many of us came out of frankly insurrectionist tradition in terms of the tradition of politics. And one of the reasons we could find it so easy to embrace the individual movement and the revolt of March 13th, or embrace the Sandinistas and so on, was largely because, you know, that was the politics we were inspired by. Unfortunately, you know, Martin Carter put his finger on it in several articles he wrote in the Thunder around the period when he was writing to them. where he talks about, and I know it is electoral politicians he has in mind, you know, the politician as an essentially untrustworthy person, because he always has to be behaving like a chameleon and, you know, presenting some face to people that people want to see. And there was in all of this a sort of slipperiness of behavior which offended Martin. He said that in special conditions, morality is like, he talked about a dog in a butcher shop. It's never thought of at the time. And in the WTA, we had a very, very strong ethos right from the beginning, not to resemble this kind of politician. And unfortunately, I believe that electoralism breeds this kind of politician, whereas insurrectionist politics and insurrectionist traditions tend not to be that kind of person. And I'm happy to say that in 1979, you did not track the electoral minded, but the insurrectionist minded.
David? Like Rupert, I feel that the third quote has not defined itself, and so we cannot come to any definitive conclusion. But I just want to say to people that were excited about the third quote that we have a history, we have a model. The Rodneyite model is the model for third quote, and that is, you have to decide whether you are a force for change, whether you are a force for change in the economic and social circumstances of people. People are poor, poverty is killing this country, disease. People, that's what people want to know. How are we going to deal with those problems? And as I said before, elections are not there to solve those problems. And so therefore, I think any third force can be very forceful. And I think the people who are behind the third force, the excitement that they're seeing is not an excitement that this third force will defeat the PNC, at an election. I think beneath that is a hope, as Rupert said, that here is a movement that can be built to change our circumstances, to make life easier for us in this country, to take us off this trip where we are forced by the circumstances to fight this racial fight. It used to be every 5 years, now we fight it every 5 days, and some of it every 5 hours. That, I think, is what people are responding to. And so, yes, if a third force is about that, then we have the Rodneyite model, which is still the best model in our post-colonial experience in order to move us forward. Walter Rodney and the WPA inspired what I call the longest racial truce in our modern history, from 1974, when Rodney came in, to 1992. The Guyanese people were preoccupied with dealing with the question of civil rights and civil liberties, dealing with the question of economic and political oppression, regardless of race. We went back to race in 1992, ironically. But from 74 to 92, our people participated in another world. They participated in a project that said another world was possible. So to the young people, I want to say, another world is possible because another world was possible, right? And so therefore, what we want to do during these Walls of Rodney Grumbling is to, in a sense, remind the nation that we don't have to look very far. Remind the third forces that we have a model on which to build on.
I like to call it the anybody but them politics. And I think that if you're going to be anybody but them politician or political force, you need very fast to say what you're about. So I believe anytime you throw something in the mix that, in a sense, tells this monolithic two-party, two-race equation is possible of some disorder, then that is to be welcomed, because I think that the two-race aspect of the country is really leading to destruction. I mean, and you could say that both of those parties articulate a different view about unity, and even present a different view. The point is that their historical relationship left them. And it's obviously as hard for them to break out as for anybody to break in. You know? So if there isn't anybody but them,
they would both very much like to break out.
Yes, I think so. And I think that the tragedy is that you have, I always look at every venture to find a conclusion, to cross over genuinely into some racial mix, whether you put a couple of politicians, a couple of ministers and so on, there's a way in which you are condemned to these historical realities.
You know, I myself, I try to take it as a point of reference that I don't like to look back too much. But we are talking about Walter Rodney in 25 years of his passing. Now, the PPP were unquestionably beneficiaries of Walter Rodney's party and its activities. What, in your view, should you attribute the ostensible, as it were, reluctance of the PPP to inquire into Rodney's death, and more importantly, the treatment of its pre-1992 allies?
On the second point, you should ask them. On the first one, I would say that it's been, to my mind, very disappointing that Shaka came here, I believe it was in 92 or 94, and fasted outside the office of one of the Santos leaders. This led them to set up the cabinet subcommittee, led to the ICJ unit coming here to investigate the possibility of holding inquiry and so on. Steps were being taken. Eventually, as you know, what happened was a few years later, we actually moved to the court and we got the court to issue an arrest warrant for Mr. Smith, charged him with murder. And then, of course, we fell foul of the fact that there was no extradition treaty with France, and in any case, France could not be sending its citizens to a country that had the death penalty and so on. And the whole thing kind of really fizzled out in what seemed to be a whole kind of diplomatic muddle that was being conducted by the Foreign Affairs Office at the time. And I would say that it remains to us a great disappointment that between 1992 and now 2005, we still have not been able to hold an international commission of inquiry to bring closure to this matter. I am not among those who believe that because of the death of Mr. Smith, we cannot have an inquiry. I think we must have the inquiry, and at some stage, I hope that things will come to light and need to come to light. But I have not, myself, given up hope that there is going to be such an inquiry. I know there's now big talk of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. I was in Virginia opening of the exhibition, which I urge you to go and see. It's very interesting. This morning. And the government spokesperson there were talking about the need for a Truth and Reconciliation activity as they had in South Africa. Well, what they ought to know as students in history is that you don't have Truth and Reconciliation Committee, a Truth Commission, before you have a framework of political consensus. That comes first. Because without a framework of political consensus, a Truth Commission simply becomes another way of managing the war.
You know, we can't close a program on Walter Rodney such as this without introducing a notion where some have argued that Rodney's association with the likes of Gregory Smith and walkie-talkies and an explosive smacks of a measure of adventurism. You know, a certain naivety of the real politics in this country. And claim that this was part of the dark composite of Rodney, such as we all are composed of. What is your view on this?
Well, I answer that. How's that? I think it's, first of all, what evidence was said in that field was declared. It's a hidden agenda. And one was fighting a state, and frankly, it was a virtue to be villainous against what we thought was an oppressive state. That certainly oppressed us. If you add up the arrests in this room, I'm sure you have none.
Yes.
You will see that they exceed, I'm sure, 100 arrests in this room. Some, they would serve long jail time, you know? So this was not a place in which we were having a little, the state was having a tea party with us either, you know? And to suggest that this was a dark side is in fact to not admit to something that the WTA spoke of. very openly, and certainly as a citizen. And who did it? It was for me an important test of one's commitment, that one was prepared to be on every front line to challenge the police who were brutalizing citizens, not to run into your own car and be hidden and so on. And I think this was seen as, if that was adventurism, to stand with the people you told to stand up for their rights, then it is an adventure as I wish to belong to.
Now, I wonder, perhaps if you could just 1 minute each. I've tried to encourage the station to give us one more.
Well, that's very kind of the station, and we will regard it as their contribution to the world around us. I want to let you use my little time to urge people to come to the ground. They're going to be held in Jocelyn and the CPU between June 9th and June 14th. There will be activities there, there will be advertising. We're urging people to come, young people in particular, but all people. Working people who would like to see there, and we would like the young people who really, as I say, belong to a generation that know next to nothing about the world. This is all becoming as a new generation. And, and I think they ought to be there. I would use my time to urge people not only here in Georgetown, but people who may be watching on the West Coast and people watching on the East Coast. There are activities organized there. There will be the groundlings at the Paradise School, Primary School on the East Coast, and the groundlings at the Damon Square in the Savona, Louisiana, and at the ISO Community Center. I'm really hoping that the public will come out and support these activities, join us in the groundlings, and to understand these are not panel discussions your professors will be giving learners teaching, but in fact a place where views can be put, arguments can be engaged, and people can be fully participatory in a number of issues that affect our daily life.
Yes, you know, I want to use my time to talk about this adventurism. You know, I was 19 years old in 1979, and I was very happy to be part of that adventure because it was an adventure that was leading to a better place. It was an adventure that was leading to a world that, as a young person, I wanted to be part of. It was an adventure that was leading to a place that spoke about a future that included decency, a future that included young people participating, older people, workers, middle class people participating in shaping the world that they belong to. So the Walter Rodney adventure, I would do it anytime, and I would recommend it anytime.
Jocelyn, final words to you.
Yes, I think, like Rupert, I'd really like to urge people, the formal opening is going to be on the 10th. And we really want to fill the hall Queens at 6. And really, it's
Queens College
at 6 o'clock on the 10th.
On the 10th
of June. And then
what day is the 10th? Friday the 10th.
And then on the 13th, we're going to invite the public to the area around where he was killed, which is John and Hatfield Street, thereabouts. Those, to me, are two important things, especially for his children, who, after all, were
taught
their age, dying when this happened, and the one of his daughters in particular. You know, these children left here under such traumatic circumstances that, in a sense, for those of us who are, you know, working on this 25th anniversary, part of it for many of us is that the children will see that their father's life was in a sense given not in vain. Because you hear so many negative things about Guyana. If you're a young child whose father has been assassinated, you must wonder what for. And there is a good reason that Walter gave his life, I believe. He was not advising being adventurous when he lost his life. You know, that is why, in fact, we must make sure that the inquiry is held. And for me, it would clearly be of great benefit to the society if we could just tell the truth about many parts of our past and let us put it behind us. That we don't drag it all the way into the 21st century. It's already gone too far. 5 years into the 21st century, and we are still talking about what happened in the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, and now we have new issues here. We need to put closure to this part of our life.
It has been my distinct pleasure, made possible by Walter Rodney, to be able to talk to three of the people that I consider worthy of talk. I wish to thank Dr. Rupert Roopnarine, Dr. David Hines, and Jocelyn Doe, who was my junior in school, she wouldn't remember. And for spending some time to reflect. There is a major revisionism, as it were, on where people are rewriting the histories that we seem to think we know about and we participated in. Once again, I commend this program to you and wish you good night and spotlight.
Thank you.
Accessibility to people of all stations in life, that even when he was writing kind of academic stuff, complex stuff, urgently feel part of it. So it was the accessibility of his writings to people of all classes, but also people seeing themselves in what he was writing, the images that he used and the experiences that he used in order to tell the story.
And I mean, this was something that you did quite programmatically. I mean, if I remember the short introduction you wrote to the How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, I mean, it ends on that very polemical question that this was not written for his colleagues in the academy. This was written to be put in the hands of people who had the responsibility to change the world. I mean, that was very much what he had to say. And talking about that particular book, you know, I was very interested. I found myself in Lisbon in 1974, just after the
Because Grongdon's came amidst his work among the Rastafari and the poor of Kingston, Jamaica, just coming out of the University of the West Indies. And you wrote it in such a way that it was easily accessible both to the working people of Jamaica and to academia. You put it together in the context of street movement. And I take him forth, as you mentioned, the whole Europe undeveloped Africa, the history of the Guyanese working people, the number of other little booklets he did and articles he did in many journals. But to come back to David's point about the balance between academia and accessibility, he had a remarkable deftness, kind of Brian Lara touching, turning the spinners around, you know. So I think that he had that capacity. Yeah.
One of the things, I mean, many of us, we who worked with him at the time, would probably have been in his presence when he was writing. Probably the most unforgettable thing about that was one day we were on the way to the quarantine and he was alone in the back seat of the car, alone with his typewriter, which was on his lap. And he was busy finishing some... One of the things that is very striking about, in particular, the history of the working people, he went to great pains at the beginning of every chapter to find an appropriate quotation, usually from Martin Carter, to head the chapter. So he had a really great sense of what I think of as the literariness of writing, that he wasn't satisfied simply with either, you know, setting forth arguments or demonstrating historical, you know, analysis, but that all along he was very conscious of the need to make the thing literary in a real sense. And I found that when he came towards the end to deal with Lakshmi and Kofi Badu, a lot of that was, you know, the question of presentation. You know, this idea that, of course, you know, it is said from time immemorial that, you know, the one thing that books cannot do is change the world. You can write books and you can read books, but books don't change the world. In a very real sense, Walter's writings are, to my mind, a complete refutation of this kind of thesis, because, of course, he did write books to change the world. He wrote them to change the world and insisted that they be put in the hands of people who would use them as really instruments of liberation and weapons in the struggle. And I was wondering, in terms of, I mean, both of you are teaching now, when students come into contact with these books, I mean, what is the kind of effect it has on them?
Well, I can tell you, this past semester, I taught a course on Caribbean society, and I used Walter Rodney as the starting point, as the core of the course. And I can tell you, black students, white students, Hispanic students, when they come into contact with Walter Rodney, they grab him. Part of it is that they had never heard of him before. And the other part was that what I introduced, when they begin to read Rodney, they found that I was being modest. At the end of the semester, I asked them to do book reviews, and I gave them a list of books, including all of Walter's books. And they snapped up. I said, first come, first serve. They all went for Walter's books. And they came, those who didn't get his books, came, Dr. Hines, can we double them? Can three of us do the book? And they really went after how Europe underdeveloped Africa. The whole concept of development and underdevelopment, how he showed in very clear terms that development was something that did not come from the genius of Europe and the genius of the United States of America, but it had something to do with the underdevelopment of other countries. And so the students declared to me afterwards, well, we now understand why there are rich countries and there are poor countries, and poor countries aren't poor because the people are lazy, but there's something, and Walter Rodney was able to bring that out in them, and they read him very, very, very closely, sometimes pointing out things that I overlooked in his work. So in terms of his writing changing the world, I can attest to that it, I can see change in young people's world in a matter of weeks as they read him in the semester.
And
same experience, how Europe undeveloped Africa, the use of the images of ancient African kings, mm-hmm. and what they did, the fact that the University of Timbuktu is one of the first universities ever talk about, yet people refer to Timbuktu sarcastically. It was a great university, long before European universities. So, yes, the same experience, wrong with my brothers, very sentences which stick out. Even in grad classes, I've heard people focus on how Europe undeveloped Africa in relation to its paradigm breaking structure, its accessibility, and the power of the scholarship, having to use it or to interpret it in some way. Especially, for example, at Binghamton, where I am, the world systems theory was one of the first places where, one of the first texts they used in analyzing a system that goes to 5 centuries. The world system, capitalist system, is Walter Rodney's How Europe Undeveloped Africa. And it's being used as a, either criticized or not, it's there as a main fulcrum of analysis. And he did go to Binghamton, was invited there for a few months in 1978 to give talks. So yes, his book has gone even beyond just nature of a book. It is really active in the world.
Mm-hmm. Do you feel that we are making enough extraordinary body of work in Guyana?
No. And I'm not saying that just as to be critical of those who are in charge of the society here. But every time I see young discover Walter Rodney and make use of him in terms of their own development, I realize that we're not using him enough here. Because those young people don't have the points of reference that, let's say, a Guyanese person reading history of the Guyanese working people or how you're going to develop Africa would have, because of living in the conditions that Walter talked about. So I don't think that we are using him enough, and I think that we are doing a disservice to the young people, because one of the things about Walter's writing is that it was local, at the same time it's international. There's that convergence there, that you see the world through Walter Rodney, so that when you read Groundings with My Brothers, you're reading about Jamaica, you're reading about Trinidad, you're reading about Guyana, but you're reading also about Africa, and you're reading about Europe at the same time. So there's this genius, I it's a word that's going around a lot, but I think Walter Rodney was essentially a genius. Nigel talked about him in Lara's sense, but I think he was more Gary Sobers than Lara. I mean, he was the complete all-rounder. I mean, there's literature coming out of there. There's history. There's politics. There's economics. You see, so look, Walter is not confined to any particular discipline, and I think a lot of it has to do with the craft. You see, as you quite rightly point out, there was craft in what he was doing, and that craft, I think, comes out of his commitment to working people, and it comes out of that.
One of the I recall when we were at one stage, we were doing some reading classes, and I can't remember if you were involved in those at Benito's house when we were reading the history of the Ganges working people. We were reading chapter one. And I thought myself, when you were writing, who sat down and said, I have to write a book, I have a book to write.
Yes.
Sat down with a book to write, and then proceeded to craft that book in a certain way. And I think you made the point that the work is full of craft. And the history of the Ganges working people, which is a mature work. It's a work of him after Europe and after all of the other writing. And so he sat here and mentioned the Ganges experience. Used with it, and the purposes of that book are very clear. And one of the central themes of the book, of course, is the racial contradiction, something that's confronting in practical life. And if you examine the imagery and the metaphors of the chapter dealing with racial contradiction, I tell you it will be illuminating.
Yeah, and then the tragedy was that it was part of a trio of books coming right up to the modern period. So 1805 was the first text, and then there would be period of the early colonial period, and then the post-war period, right up to the independence period of Britain. So we've lost the vast trove of analysis in the way that Rupert described it. Race as a contradiction among the working people became even more visceral and visible in the 1950s and 1960s when the anti-colonial movement had begun and was trying to challenge itself. So yes, we missed what is to be done. I mean, in that period, that gap is very, very, very key.
I see a very clear kind of tradition, if you like, of this kind of writing. I mean, perhaps the most underestimated writer in our history of this kind is Yusuf Quayle.
Mm-hmm.
I've said to people, and it remains a work to be done, Nigel and I had started this some years ago, but, Yusuf's writings, a lot of which were, of course, fugitive, because he was writing, for tomorrow. But when you think of the body of work that he has left behind, it really, we're talking several volumes of important writing. And what you find in Quayle's writing is really that same tradition, that writing to be read by simple people, ordinary people, and to be used by them for transformation. So that they also had in common this sort of importance of telling the story of those whose story would never be told.
Mm-hmm.
That history was not about the doings of kings and prime ministers and parliaments, but it was about the doing of the people who were making the history, who were producing, whose labor was driving the society. And Quayle, of course, was a great example to Walter, not only in terms of his political practice, but I believe also in terms of his intellectual work and his theoretical work and his writing. And they both, to my mind, stood in a certain relationship to literature, to poetry, to drama, that they were both very keen on those dimensions of literature that we think of as literary, and the way that carried over into the work that did not propose itself in the first instance as literary, proposed itself as history, or proposed itself as studies of the media, or something like that. But in effect, were always completely contaminated by literary ideas and so on. The children's books. This was a surprising thing. And it's difficult to talk about the end of Walter's life. The man was 38. It's really extraordinary. Mm-hmm. But in that final period, let's say the final 2 years of his life, he devoted a lot of attention to these books. He only completed two of them. Lakshmi, which had to be done from a lot of his writings, and I, who was doing an enormous amount of work with his books at that stage, was able to put together. But he had the one on Fongafat out of China.
Mm-hmm.
There were a number that were projected.
Portuguese, the albums out of Portugal.
That's right. And to cover all the
the groups in Guyana and to show their origins and the history and so on. I've thought that as a very important project. Why do you think he put so much energy into that towards the end?
Well, I think he really understood the power of the youth and felt that a lot of what passed for politics excluded young people. And so I think he wanted to speak directly to the young people and to speak to them on a very important issue, that the issue of race. So it was speaking to the young people, but it was also engaging them on this question of race and racial unity and so forth. I think sometimes when we talk about Rodney and multiracialism, we tend to think that this multiracialism was above speaking directly to different race groups. There was a synthesis of speaking directly to Africans, speaking directly to Indians, speaking directly to Portuguese, but also at the same time speaking to them as a mass of people. So, you know, we like to talk about this dialectical thing, but that was very much part of Walter's thing. As I said, he was speaking to Guyana at the same time, he was speaking to African Europe. He was speaking to young people at the same time. He was speaking to the world, but he was also speaking about race and ethnicity. I think he saw that power. I like to say that I joined the Rodney movement at age 15, and Rodney made me grow up, because at age 15, I felt like I was age 30, because in a sense, what Rodney said to us young people was that this is your world. Here is how you can shape this world, and here is this world. And since as young people, we try to decide what we want to do with our future, Rodney was able to inspire us that there was a world that cared for us, but that we had to be part of shaping that world. So I think he was dead serious about communicating with young people. I mean, after all, I mean, he was 38. I mean, Rupert, you guys when you're 30s. And we, I mean, Nigel and Karen D'Souza, Wazi Mohammed, we were teenagers when we got into that movement. So the youth was very much part of the Rodney movement, and he took it very, very seriously.
So seriously that I think my own involvement in the first time I met Rodney actually was at an invitation from professors inviting me in South Bryan's house to have a bottom house class. And he had a class in this bottom house between 1976 and 1977, where he would speak to middle class people, young youth, working class people were there on benches, rickety benches. He would bring down Morby and biscuits and stuff like that, and he was talking about Guyanese history, talking about method, the Marxist method, he's talking a whole range of issues, and that was my introduction. So yes, it's a consistent line in Rodney, right through to the point where he began to write those children's books. And I also think he saw a gap in the, it was what they had, the story of, children's story of Bear, Beaver or something like that, I can't remember the name, but that was the only text around about children's understanding Guyanese history. He sought to make an intervention which is not only dramatic in terms of encompassing, also dramatic in terms of its content, what history really means, coming over the slave trade, coming over in a dark ship as a child, coming over in indentured labor ship from India, coming over from Portugal by the indentured as well, and Chinese. It's really remarkable. And to bring all of those into what David said is a national cohesion, not from the standpoint of saying... Not from the standpoint of saying multiracial and keeping up the blend, you know, just blending into one, like say Kofi Badu, but blending the Guyanese people into the several strains that they came from, the Guyanese youth. I think that's sort of remarkable.
You know, Rupert, one thing my students pointed out to me this past semester, the red people's overloaded. And they had no idea it was a speech. Absolutely no idea. When I told them it was a speech afterwards, they were amazed. Because in speeches, when you put them on paper, they read like a book.
Well, that's because it's a spoken paragraph.
Exactly. And I want to point that out. Also say that you can spot a speech when you see it. But with Walter Rodney, there was that, always that commitment and the consistency. He was very clear about what he was about. So when he spoke or he wrote, it was the same message and the same method that he used. It was to communicate to people, what Quina calls giving back to people their own experiences so they can use it to nourish.
It's a very important point, because I think one of the things that is immediately engage him about his writing and then you read his book. You can hear the voice and you can hear the tone.
Mm-hmm.
And the tone was always reasonable.
Mm-hmm.
And the voice was very seductive.
Yeah.
And it was that voice and that tone that guided you along in terms of the book.
And you, Mathieu.
I think we're out of time, so I'm being signaled by the producer that we should call a halt to this. Well, thank you both very much, and thank Pitamba for giving us this opportunity to have a little discussion about what is writing. Thank you.
The world of communications is changing. Life is getting faster, and customers are becoming more mobile. You're accustomed to getting access locally, but now you can make contact even if you're in another country, like here or here. The new age of communications technology brings with us international roaming.
We're an era of dictatorship.
We had many talks with Dr. Jagan. At one time, there was some consideration of his coming into the People's Progressive Party, and he expressed a view that probably it would be better for him to stay outside of the PPP and to continue the work of exposing the PNC government, as all of us were engaged in fighting for the restoration of democracy during that period.
In June 1999, the People's Progressive Party, PPP, and a Mirror newspaper article said, Dr. Rodney must be remembered for his role in the anti-dictatorship struggle led by the PPP.
Dr. Rodney was undoubtedly one of the greatest historians and an intellectual par excellence. Most significantly, he embodied the spirit of national unity, a zeal and commitment to building lasting national unity equal to that of the father of our independence struggle, former President Dr. Teddy Gagan. One of my personal regrets was not being able to meet Dr. Rodney.
A member of the Working People's Alliance, WPA, Walter Rodney will forever be remembered for his contribution to the working class movement in this country. A great man he was for Guyana and for the WPA.
We feel that what Walter had to say is still very important for the world as a whole and important for Guyana. You know, it was a dogma with him. He was the least dogmatic of people. But the single dogma which he really held was that until we dealt with the racial division in Guyana among the working people, we will not advance as a nation. That remains true 25 years after the Guyana. And I see that as part of the unfinished work of the Rodney agenda. As far as the world is concerned, as you know, the division of the world now into the rich countries and poor countries, the gap between them is wider than it ever was at the time of old. The unequal and unfair distribution of the world's wealth, the very unjust arrangements for international trade, all of these things point to a need to mobilize the energies of people who really want to fight for a better world. And I think that Rodney, someone we produced in Guyana, is an enormous inspiration.
Walter Rodney was killed on Friday, June 30, 1980, when a bomb exploded in his car. Donald Rodney, his brother who was driving the car, was subsequently charged for possession of an explosive device. Rodney had issued a statement the said night saying that it was one Gregory Smith of the Guyana Defense Force who gave him the device. Dr. Rodney, a scholar, a historian, and a political activist, was in the struggle to restore democracy to the country. It was for this reason that he was disliked by the then administration.
In Guyana, it is now, I think, widely known inside the country and outside of the country that first of all, the Americans intervened along with the British to abort the democratic process from 1953 onwards. And secondly, that once the present government got into power, it extended the scale of electoral fraud so that we cannot claim at the present time to be a politically enfranchised people. We cannot claim to have chosen our own national government. And that is one level. Below that level, you find that there is reproduced in every facet of the national life the same anti-democratic tendencies. So that there are no local government elections, for instance. They have local government elections that are postponed every time they become due with ease, with no concern whatsoever, with no reaction. There are no elections taking place within certain trade unions, where workers at that basic level should be choosing their representatives to deal with their material interests. And once that anti-democratic principle is established, we see then step by step we move backwards.
From the time Dr. Rodney returned in 1974, the PNP dictatorship declared him an enemy of the state. He was denied employment at the University of Guyana, and to be followed by years of harassment and subsequent brutal killing and assassination. Could you imagine that one of our greatest minds, loved and respected throughout the world, particularly in the continent of Africa, was denied the opportunity to share his knowledge and simply earn a decent living in the land of his birth?
Those were the times of Guyana. Political leaders resorted to violence to solve problems. The oppression was severe. There was no hope for young people and Guyanese as a whole.
I think it was very difficult for politicians to get beyond a certain point in their relationship. And part of the tragedy of this nation is that from then our politics has gone public to interfere with relationships at a very personal level. And for me, that is something I regret.
Eddie Rodney, the eldest of the Rodney brothers, recalls his brother's uncompromising commitment for national unity and human liberation and empowerment.
As we grew up, I think because colonial society oppressed us all, I think he felt a particular sense of loss when the Constitution was suspended in 1950. And that may have been the trigger for him being the kind of activist that he was. He felt that the suspension of the 1953 Constitution threw the country back. It made the people more vulnerable. It made the task of the political leaders more arduous and difficult. That may have been the reason why, when he went on to Queen's College, he studied so relentlessly, he studied so assiduously to achieve his objective.
During his years at school, Eddie Rodney recalled Walter used to be cool and try and understand everything. He did not want to be a Guyana scholar, as in those days his brother said, you couldn't be a scholar when you were from the working class. His parents were from the plantation system. His father was a tailor.
There are unique individuals. And these unique individuals actually have tremendous influence on movement. Sometimes you can really cause things to happen. For me, Walter Rodney was a difference.
You will not meet somebody like Walter Rodney for the next 100 years. He is so unique, he is so icon, as the minister said, that there would not be anybody like him for a very long time. And you young people cannot comprehend the kind of person he was. I will have to explain, and yet it isn't, I tell you about him, because he was like a brother. You can watch him in his eyes and tell him things that pain you, and he would start to cry. I always said to him, you could never rule this country. He said, why? I said, you have too much feelings of humanity, and that will not make a president, because when you have to make harsh decisions, you will pull away from it. And used to watch it me and laugh.
Locally and abroad, there was consensus about the alleged PNC government involvement in the killing of Dr. Rodney. The Barbados Sunday Sun newspaper at that time, in a front page editorial, blamed the government of the day for the killing. It was murder, a chilling reminder of the depth to which men and women of power can sink to perpetuate themselves in office, it stated. It said Rodney's sin was that his party had pledged to work for the downfall of a government for which it deemed to be dictatorial and intent on staying in power by any means. Rodney was the third WPA member to meet a violent death under the PNC regime in 1979 and 1980. The other two were Ohimu Koyuna and Edward Dublin. Dr. Rodney had spoken out on numerous occasions against the atrocities of the then government, including the suppressed media.
We find that since the government has taken over the papers, it has ostensibly nationalized these newspapers, meaning in the interest of the nation, but in practice it is specifically in the interest of the ruling party. As the Prime Minister of this country himself once cynically remarked, he says, the government never tells the newspapers what to print, they simply tell them what not to print. And then they go beyond that. They're not prepared to allow competing centers of information so that they utilize illegal machinery to crush things like the Mirror, the People's Progressive Party's newspaper, the Day Clean, which is a newsheet printed by the Working People's Alliance. They have made it impossible for a political organization to print a newspaper. That organization then resorted to millions offering a piece, but the government considered it absolutely essential to continue to persecute it, to go to the level of seasoned typewriters to make it impossible for people to type and produce an immigrant piece.
University lecturer at that time, Dr. James Rose, in a Guyana Chronicle of June 30, 1995, said many attempts were made to get at Rodney, and the assassination was no surprise. They actually said they were going to get him, he said. Born in Georgetown on March 23, 1942, of poor and humble parentage, Rodney attended Queen's College after completing primary school. He won an open scholarship and later went to the University of the West Indies, Mona Campus, where he graduated with a first-class honors degree in history. At the age of 24, he was awarded a PhD in African history from the School of Oriental and Black Studies in London. Dr. Rodney made his name in Guyana, the Caribbean, and a number of other countries.
What Rodney was a legend while he was still alive. In the academic community of his first university, he was a legend.
He first taught in Tanzania before returning to the University of the West Indies in Jamaica. It was in this period of great political activity in the Caribbean that the Black Power movement captured his attention. With this struggle in mind, Rodney returned to his birthplace in 1974 to take up the position of professor of history at the University of Guyana. But the PNC government rescinded his appointment. At that time, the PNC, under the leadership of Forbes Burnham, already controlled two-thirds majority in the parliament after the 1973 rigged election. This failed to daunt Rodney's spirit, as he did not succumb to the political machinations of the PNC.
It wasn't extraordinary in the sense of you associating him with being someone powerful. The guy was just modest. He's communist, he's done, you know, and see what's happening, you know, what's going on, you know, rapidly. So I was able to understand how it was that in East Africa, people came from different parts of Tanzania, from Kenya, from Uganda, just to listen to one speak. This was in 1967, '68, when he was banned from re-entering Jamaica. I was able to understand because he drove fear into the ruling class. They were afraid just to listen to him explain an issue and to deal with this issue in the most simple form and then move back to its complexity and move back again and then show relationship with what is happening at the present time and point the finger at the people who were the oppressed. Walter Rodney drove fear into the ruling class. And I mean the ruling classes in Canada, Britain, Jamaica, and at that time, it
On June 1, the Government Information Agency launched a photographic exhibition on the life and work of the late Dr. Walter Rodney at the National Library.
What Gina has done here is a very wonderful.
I think it lays out well, you know, the basic periods in Walter's life, and it's really very good for students. So people should come.
I didn't know half of those things. I learned of Walter Rodney. I heard the name a few times before, but now I really know about the things he did for the country and for all the people, you know, Persian and all the people in the working class and so on.
Minister for Labour, Human Services and Social Security, Dr. Dale Bisnall, who launched the exhibition, said Dr. Rodney's death really robbed this country of truly radical revolution.
People knew. The oppressors knew that Walter Rodney had been allowed. This country would have been different. Not only did he provide a vision, but he made that vision so real as to what could be in the future that one felt compelled to be engaged in the present in a particular way in order that vision might be realized.
The PDG has always committed to bring the perpetrators of Dr. Rodney's killing to justice.
Those with blood on their hands need to come clean. As a nation, we need closure. More importantly, and perhaps we may say sadly, there are those who are still politically active in the opposition who can help in bringing this closure. Perhaps this month of celebration of the life and the work of Dr. Rodney is an opportune time. But the Government Information Agency has started this year the annual exhibition. It's an indication of the government, and I'm quite sure the people of Guyana's determination to let the name of Dr. Walter Rodney live on and let generations to come understand and benefit from his teaching and what he stood for.
President Barra Chagbio recently announced an international inquiry into Rodney and other political killings, which the PNCR said they support. Eddie Rodney commended the efforts of the government to bring the perpetrators of his brother's gruesome killing to justice.
Indeed, it may not be surprising to discover that in Guyana at the time that Walter was killed, they were Nazis in the PNC.
Hubert Rodney, a younger brother, said appreciation is still lacking of the struggles and sufferings of his brother.
But Walter was part of a disciplined movement. Walter didn't act on his own. There were movements against oppression. There were individuals who had much more political experience than Walter did. And those people joined with Walter to deal with the oppression that's confronting the Guyanese working. So we should not today stand to celebrate Walter's achievements alone. We must see him as part of a wider circle.
25 years later, the name of Dr. Rodney remains prominent as a bat of a hero. But what is talked about and remembered most?
I think Rodney was a very positive element in the struggle. Certainly a great man, a prominent writer, and historian, and the great pity, of course, is that he died so young. That's a pity. He should have been here now.
In all his messages, he sent clear signals that the way forward for Guyana must be premised on ethnic solidarity, ethnic unity, ethnic appreciation, and joint action, according to Dr. James Rowe. To all young people, Dr. Bisnall's advice is,
you have got to grasp future in your imagination, and then you have got to employ those engineering skills that would make that future a possibility. And if you want an icon, if you want a life, study, contemplate, that it might be an inspiration to you. Look to Walrond.
The DPPC administration remains committed to the task of bringing to justice those criminals who assassinated Dr. Walter Rodney to ensure that the mistakes of the past are not repeated.
Relevance it has to our situation here in Guyana, and then of course we try to solicit some opinions, some views, some comments, whatever comments you, the viewer, have out there about the main part of our program, where we can interact with you to be able to get all of us to come to some conclusion about the issue we're discussing. Well, the issue this evening is not really an issue as such, which we're going to be talking about, but is life escape. And this to me is one of the greatest tragedies that there possibly can be. Because here was an individual born in 1942, and at the age of 24 was able to have accomplished and completed a PhD, a doctorate in history, which is a tremendous intellectual undertaking to be able to focus your energies, your thoughts, and your whole powers of analysis on a particular problem to be able to come out with a doctoral dissertation, to be able to satisfy the individuals at this university, in England as the case may be, to be able to persuade them that you have made an original contribution on the topic that you have made. And this man did that, and he didn't stop there. That was just the very beginning of an intellectual career that is incredible. I have two children who graduated from a university in New Jersey called Rutgers, and they called me up one day to say, well, they were studying an individual by the name of Walter Rodney, who's from Guyana. This is the extent of the reach of this individual, that I don't think there's a program on history in any part of the third world where the name of Dr. Walter Rodney will not be referred to. His work, a seminal work into how Europe underdeveloped Africa, a seminal work in the field, and one which almost paradoxically is very, very accessible to individuals, yet it made a major contribution to how we look at our situation in the world. After a stellar academic career, returned to Guyana to do a remarkable thing, which is to get engaged in the politics of Guyana, because from a very early age he had discerned that there were severe problems in the very formulation of politics in Guyana, and he wanted to make a contribution. He wanted to make a contribution that would go somewhere. Early in his life, he said, well, it's not right for him to return to Guyana, because the situation was in such a log jam, that he didn't feel that he could make a contribution. But eventually he did, by 1974, returned to Guyana, joined a party which had just been formed the year before, I believe, the Working People's Alliance. Around that same time, my guest will give me the date exactly, but the party has participated in one of the most fertile period of Guyana's history between 1974 and his unfortunate assassination in 1980. And this is what we want to talk about today. But here's a man whose legacy spanned Africa, the Caribbean, and Guyana, and yet today in Guyana, to my great consternation, disappointment, disbelief, he is not widely known. Because the point of all of this, of course, is that he dedicated his whole life towards showing that intellectual activity cannot be in a vacuum. It must be related to the life of the people, and in some way to be able to help those individuals who want to make a living to move on. And if any people on planet Earth need some help in telling us how we can maybe live to be able to move forward in a direction where we all want to go, which is to live the good life in whatever form it might be, Dr. Rodney has suggestions, proposals, analysis which can help all of us. So tonight we're going to be talking about Dr. Walter Rodney, his life and his legacy. Our guest this evening is an individual who from a very young age joined this movement, joined the Working People Alliance, and he himself went through this process of living one's beliefs, and he is an individual familiar to all of us, I'm sure, Dr. David Hinds, originally from Buxton, teaching in the United States, and who's come back on this grounding where we're remembering Dr. Rodney's 21st anniversary of his assassination. Welcome to the program.
Thank you, Robin, for having me.
Well, it's really an honor because I have tried to study Rodney's work as an individual who never met him in the flesh, so to speak. And to me, it's one of the things that I miss a lot when I talk to individuals like yourself who actually interacted with this remarkable man. Let's talk about the individual itself. In Hindu philosophy, they ask, a question is asked in one of the ancient texts, who is the teacher, who is the acharya?
And the answer comes back, not the individual who understands the text, not the individual who analyzes the text, but the individual who understands, analyzes, but lives with the text.
And to me, this is what I, as an outsider, so to speak, to Walter's life, saw in him. He was an individual who tried to live the truth that he unearthed as he conducted his intellectual explorations. Would you want to comment on that?
One of the things that drew me to Rodney and the movement that he was building at the time was the fact that he was different from the other leaders that I had encountered as a youngster. In fact, he was indeed part of what he spoke about. He was prepared, therefore, to be on the ground with those of us he was trying to inspire. So he was not a leader who was out there or up there, but a leader with the people. So he's a different kind of leader. And I was young person and some of the other young people, and he was definitely struck by that. There was a term that was used at the time, and I'm reminded of this in an article, in an interview recently. Even a forwarder, he was somebody who was forwarding, who wasn't really just speaking and trying to tell you what you must do, but he was a person who was prepared to come down on the ground and work.
Let me pick up on that, because you would have been fairly young notion of, you tell a bottle, little bottle, little mix with big bottle, you know?
Yeah.
So coming back, here's an individual coming back, a PhD, a renowned scholar and all that. How did he, in a sense, close that gap between you, a younger person of our time, late teens probably, and himself, not much older in age, but in terms of this intellectual background on which his world contacts and the experience he could draw upon, how was he able to make that connection a little concrete?
Yeah, two things. It's humility. That was, of course. I mean, when you meet these people who achieve so much in life, you have to break the ice, so to speak, in order to connect with them. Well, I mean, from the time you met Walter Rodney, I mean, he broke the ice.
There was no ice there.
There was no ice, really, ice left. He connected. But I think more importantly, as someone who was born in Boston, grew up there, very poor, and so forth, here was someone who was talking about poor people in a dignified way.
Huh? Almost from within.
Yes, and who was saying to me that you're poor, you're young, but you have dignity. And you come from a history, a dignified history. So what he did is that he was able to locate a youngster, 15-year-old youngster, 16-year-old youngster, in a kind of historical continuum. He gave you a sense of importance, a sense of being connected to you, that there was something that you were doing here in Boston by going to school and trying to educate yourself, that linked you with somebody in Jamaica, in Africa, in the United States of America. So you felt a sense of importance. And I think that, for me, was extremely unique, that as a 15 years old, to hear Walter Rodney say that history is not made by leaders and kings and queens, but by ordinary people in their villages, in their towns, in their neighborhoods, doing what they do every day, that is to recreate themselves, trying to make a living, trying to educate their children, trying to educate themselves, that is history. And that those of us who were sitting there at his feet, because he was on the floor when he came to Boston Port, and he was sitting around him, that those of us, as we were talking there, we were making history. So that was exciting.
You were revolutionary.
For a 15-year-old.
But I want to pose this to you, because first of all, the whole notion of dignity is remarkable, because in war, there's a Urdu word called izzat, which means dignity. And it's a word we, in a sense, put back into our lexicon in war, because we found that the indentured immigrants, it was a word that they used a lot. They were seeking dignity, meaning dignity comes from within. You know, respect, you have to maybe depend on somebody from the outside, but dignity is how is within you, who you are, knowing what you are. So we resonate to that. I really am remarkable that, from the beginning, felt that that was what it was all about for us as a people who had just passed through slavery and indentation.
And as black people coming out of slavery,
pioneer, in fact, the kind of work that Roe does, I see out of that focus on identity, culture, that kind of thing. You see, Kwame is a man who, in a sense, put that on the front burner in Guyana. And we have to talk about that. But come back to it, didn't you see already, from his work in Asquia, had he set the ground for that kind of thinking to, in a sense, be fertile then?
Very important. That's a very important point. As we celebrate Walter, we have to put him in context.
That's right.
And someone was going to celebrate,
where would Walter fall in terms of Guyanese public leaders?
And I said, the closest I keep coming to is the UC Choir, that tradition of good work among people, empowering others.
And living the truth.
And so therefore, yes, the UC have done that kind of work. The UC have done that kind of cultural work, so that culturally, as a young people, you are prepared to deal with the world. What Walter did is to take that cultural consciousness and really take it out into the political sphere. Now, the UC was political, but UC is a unique person. Eh? Mm-hmm. UC was injecting new political consciousness, making a front for me, was very big on the cultural, bringing up that sense of the cultural sphere. That here as a black person, you're a person of worth, that you come out of slavery, you come out of slavery with dignity again.
But let me then take it from, I think, what you're implying. I just want to make sure that you're heading that. In a sense, what Walter brought was this wider experience that he had gathered.
Yes.
Walter interestingly defines himself in one of his books as a Guyanese, a black, and an African.
Mm-hmm.
So let's start with the last one, because here's a man who very early on made his decision, and it was an interesting article in the newspaper that Brian Moore said that he talked to Arthur in the Fourth Firm, and from the Fourth Firm, I guess Walter and some others were inspired to study history, and especially the history of slavery and what have you, because the whole focus of the same history in terms of the historiography was changing. And Walter got onto that, and as he said, went to Africa, or studied African history, wrote History of the Upper Guinea Coast, 1545, I think, to 1800. So as an African, and who, in a sense, has made a contribution in Africa that today resounds throughout the continent, how did Walter relate that to what was happening in Boston? To Boston in the young world.
Yes, so the whole question of the African diaspora, the whole question of African being the people, the only people in Guyana were brought in chains.
In a sense, the only people
who were brought in chains. But that was a unique example.
Right.
And so therefore, in order to understand two black people, wherever they find themselves in the world, one has to go back to the source, if you will, and the source of Africa.
Mm-hmm.
So as a youth choir, I started over the whole campaign to, in a sense, lead Africans towards reclaiming their identity. And in terms of the connection to Africa.
And remaking that connection.
Here was Walter coming as someone who had lived in Africa.
Mm-hmm.
you see, and who has used the weapon of history.
But it's not theory anymore.
It is not theory anymore. This is the practical thing you're seeing there. But here was this man who said, I am an African at a time when people dare not say that. And then he was standing up and saying,
haven't changed much, but that's another story. Go on.
I'm an African, and if someone is going to use my race to dehumanize me, I'm going to use my race to humanize myself. Mm-hmm. My God, mm-hmm. when you heard that mm-hmm. as a young man, you said, yes. This is what I want.
From a different focus, he wasn't a historian, psychologist. So in a sense, he looked a bit more in the inner landscape mm-hmm. In terms of identity, in terms of what had been done to the Africans. Mm-hmm. Fanon, of course, we're talking about.
Right.
Did Walter relate that directly? Because in his own works, one does not see the direct references to Fanon. One can see some of the allusions. Mm-hmm. So on a personal basis, did he relate that in terms of what Fanon's experience was?
Yes, later on I would find myself later on.
Also, we're not at the time when
you... No, also the type of person who wouldn't throw around jars and the names and so forth.
Okay.
But then you would finish with you when you were 11 to go look for a lot of people.
Okay.
So in that sense, he inspired you to, in fact, enlarge your horizons, broaden your horizons. Alright? And because he concentrated less on the particular, which is where you are.
Mm-hmm.
But this particle was part of a larger, broader universe. And in that sense, also was a nationalist and an internationalist at the same time. You know, there's something to have to be internationalist, but also was both a nationalist and an internationalist at the same time. But in that he spoke...
Okay, you're right down to the center.
He was. In that he spoke to us, he was a Bostonian, a Bayanese. You were African, but you were also part of a larger group of oppressed people.
That's the black part. We'll come to that just now, right?
Yes.
I want to start at the back with that African portion, because when I looked at the corpus of his work, of course it was truncated because of his assassination. One sees, even though his first paper that you can come across is a piece on slavery done, I think he might have still been in high school,
right.
There was that piece on slavery, yet he did not pursue the in-depth kind of study on slavery that, for example, his contemporary Orlando Patterson has done, with glaring results in looking at that. But he, in a sense, jumped behind that. Mm-hmm. To look what in terms of what preceded slavery. Now, one thought I had that possibly that was because he rejected the notion that the history of the black people here began with slavery, which I think is still a fallacy that many people hold, as if African and slavery had come out only of slavery, that there was nothing behind that, which of course we all know to be non-true. So hence Walter's earlier for sure, there was something concrete.
That was a very critical aspect of Walter's work, and mm-hmm. I think those of us who...
So you made a choice consciously to do that?
Consciously.
At the age of 20?
Yes. And this is a legacy of risk.
Yes.
To those of us today who do African diaspora studies and so forth, because really to make sense of what the black man is today, wherever he finds himself, wherever she finds herself, one has to go back to that beginning. Alright? So that there was something called African University. There was something called an African civilization that was destroyed.
To show that the black man brought something into equation.
Exactly.
And we can also realize that part.
Exactly. And a part of the contradiction that we're dealing with today is that I don't think people quite appreciate the fact that black people, African people, brought something to this country called Guyana.
Well, I'll jump to that when we come to the Guyanese part, because part of my criticism is exactly that even so-called black leaders don't think positive in that thing called black, which can actually add to where we're heading in this thing that we want to construct called Guyana. But I come back to that. So basically, therefore, his African studies and his African experiences, you're saying, adds an international dimension to the Guyana dialectic.
Yes.
And he made it, young people like us were very conscious of that connection.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. We also felt part of something larger.
Mm-hmm.
So you were dealing with Guyana, mm-hmm. you were dealing with African Guyana,
mm-hmm.
you were dealing with the conditions in Guyana, but you knew you were part of something called the Caribbean.
Mm-hmm.
And you knew you were something part something called the African Diaspora. Mm-hmm. I remember when I heard that poem first used by Dr. Kimani and Dr. Crazy and Coke in the village, and then Walter comes to give life to that word, diaspora, and I suddenly realized, what is this diaspora thing? So you knew that you were part of a larger thing. You knew that you were part of what the Black American was struggling with.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a consciousness of yourself being part of this larger struggle for Black empowerment.
Mm-hmm.
But more importantly to Walter, it did not stop at Black empowerment. It was working class empowerment. So that you were Black, but there was something that differentiated between the Black poor and the Black ruling class and the Black rich class. That was always part of the difference.
So let's come back to our point. So that Walter was Guyanese,
yes,
Black and African. So let's come to the Black part, which you've introduced.
Mm-hmm.
Here is where I thought there was an element of ambiguity that I want to explore with you, because Walter very carefully, in knowing what was going on in America, where the whole notion of Black power had originated, in looking at it in a West Indian context, at Mona, then 68, in Jamaica, he makes a careful distinction that for the West Indians, Black power meant all those who were non-white.
Yeah.
And in terms of Guyana, he was very specific that the Indians would have to be included within that notion.
Mm-hmm.
So when one looks at the whole notion of African, there is that element in terms of the cultural contribution of what Africa has given to humanity. But when you come to the Black film, he now changes the analysis to in a sense define a people or a set of people vis-a-vis the white, the grouping. But my problem with that is this, David, and I want to explore how did it play out, because I know overall it played out that unity that he talked about in terms of people seeing themselves as opposed to whites, and therefore, in a sense, coming back to some conscience of that, has not gone anywhere, or has not gone anywhere far. So I want to point this out to you, that when Walter does a thing like that, to say, well, all those who are not white are Black, that's an analytical distinction. But for that, even as Marx said, for that to become something of a group in itself, in a sense, for that consciousness to be imbibed, there would need to be work, there would need to be some paradigm into which those people will fit themselves into.
Mm-hmm.
So I saw the contradictions of that very early on, that within the Caribbean, I didn't see how it will actually play out, because not everyone defined themselves as such. How did that play out in Boston?
I think Walter was driving at the old question of Black power.
Yeah,
Walter made a clear distinction between what's called white power and Black power. And the white power were those who were carrying out victory of the white imperial world of the age. And so that the Caribbean and African ruling classes, which were oppressing ordinary Black and Indian and brown people, that they were part of white power. And so when you talk about Indians being part of Black power, you see, it's not just that they were Black.
No.
Yeah, they were part of this
economic oppression.
Exactly. So Black power was not just a cultural thing. It was also socio-economic.
No, I understand that.
Yes.
But I'm saying that has to be then fed back to the people.
Yes.
So the people then can identify with that notion,
right,
and in a sense become a group in themselves, meaning a social group,
yes,
one that acts on this premise.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, that was where the gap was. But I felt that, in a sense, what he was trying to do, he was trying to work with African people,
mm-hmm,
or people of African descent in Jamaica, and using terminology that came out of a Black experience in America, and in trying to merge these two, and in understanding the complexity of West Indian society, I thought he was bringing in a term which might have added confusion to things, because he was therefore equating the Marxist notion of class, to be good about it,
yeah,
with color.
Mm-hmm.
And I think in a sense it added a level of confusion where, for example, by the time the Black family was with Trinidad,
mm-hmm,
Bades Maraj was willing to take up arms against those who would march into the cane field.
Right.
Because they interpreted the use of the word Black to be African. So the question arises, why didn't Walter proceed on a Marxist basis without bringing in the notion of Black? Meaning, why not a straight class analysis of that juncture?
Well, Walter, I think, was the kind of person who said that one had to forward and deal with the challenge. And certainly, what you pointed out, there was a challenge.
Of course,
yes. It's a complex society, and it has to be complex given what it came out of. And so I think it was Walter's way of challenging the complexity and trying to see how we can work through it so that we can keep our people connected. But interestingly, for us, our number of young people, we were more interested in the power aspect of black power. And so the black for us was never the big issue. And this is what I came into contact later on when Walter came back with Indian young people. What drew them was the power rather than the black. But I hear you in terms of the contradiction. Mm-hmm. And some people say it's true to the state of war. It's one thing that Walter never really resolved.
Well, I think so, but you see, my thing, I made the point at an earlier function in Walter's name, and I want to say to him, we can maybe talk a little bit about it, because you are the moderator and you want to book the comment. My point is this, and I've made it several times on public television in Guyana here, is this, that I follow Orlando Patterson in terms of how he looks at slavery and slavery of the African man, that it happened at a time coincident with the whole Western Enlightenment. So as white people defined all their structures, at the same time, the black experience, they were utilizing blacks as slaves. So part and parcel of that whole definition of what the West is all about is tied in and linked with the African man, because it's not black as per se, it's African because it happened at a particular historical contingency.
Right.
So my contention was that, in a sense, Walter diluted the power of his argument to put on the front burner this juxtaposition that all the white world was talking about, whether it was a liberal vision, whether it was a Marxist vision. But in either of those two visions, which were dominant at the time, the place for black was still at the bottom. Even Marx did not see anything positive in African civilization and culture. He saw capitalism as a modernizing force which would wipe away all these vestiges in Asia also. And he spoke of course especially to India. Mm-hmm. But the point is, even within that world, the African culture, the African contribution was nowhere to be found.
Mm-hmm.
Yet here was Walter talking about African contribution in terms of hospitality, in terms of all of the things that they lived, their life. And because he didn't play that game of saying, you are the university, we are the university. Mm-hmm. That was not the point. The point is what the civilizational content of the African man, his ethos in terms of living, in dealing with diversity, in able to contribute something to this world as to how you could live together without these major wars of 20 million being killed and so people don't talk about white people being savages. So to come back to it, my point is that, to me, the whole conflation of black power, trying to include Indians because I think to be politically correct, I think in a sense put back the black struggle to a certain extent here. So that the dilemma of the African man has not been foregrounded, as we say nowadays. You know, you have to say a comment on that?
I think. Walter accepted the Marxian, Marxist methodology of acquiring a society. And there were lots of things about Marxism that I think, I certainly would reject that combination of African people.
I hope so.
At the bottom. But I think that was leading to reject all of Marxism. Right? And as I mentioned before, I think Walter took the situation from one point to another. But he was not always correct because he was always grappling. And I like to say, correctly, that Walter was the type of person who changed his mind. That he was part of a particular point, and 5 years later, the whole history proved what he was saying not to be correct. He was prepared to change his mind. But he was very, very, very clear that what was important in the past, in the slavery and indentureship that followed, and even before that, I mean the oppression of the native Indians, the Amerindians, to the black issue. But by the time he came to Guyana, He felt that that was not the most important task, because here you had what? A black government in power that was oppressing black people, Indian people, Amerindian people, Chinese people, Portuguese people. So I support them fast for the moment. But I check your point. But today, that has come back as a very urgent task. And so therefore, it should move on. And how we use the Rodney principles, how we use the ideas of Rodney, but how we act the world at any point in time, then we'll have to inevitably categorize societies as backward and forward. Mm-hmm. And this is my point, that Marx's premise, and within Marx's civil premise, there were backward cultures. Mm-hmm. And the epitome of them, where they are, especially looking at where this so-called enlightened view has led us.
Yeah.
But I'll come back.
That's right.
African country. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So the last thing now is the Guyanese aspect. Rodney was a Guyanese, but he didn't come out to Guyanese. He was working in Guyana. So here's a man who give the Guyanese, especially young people, a flavor of how Rodney was able to, because nowadays a lot of people, they tell me they cannot be committed to the struggle. They see there's a need for a struggle because man and have gotten good money. Yet he came back here with his family without a job now. How did that play out? How did this man live?
Well, he would leave, go to the United States, go to London, go to other parts of Europe, teach for 2 and 3 months, mm-hmm. come back here, do his work, leave for another 2 to 3 months, and that's how he made a living. I mean, it was really difficult to really write and so forth. But that kind of what I observed him during that time, but that was not the most important thing in his mind. For him, the most important thing was dealing with the situation of his concerning himself in deliberately.
But the point I want to make, and come back to the lesson for us today, how can we then encourage, through Walter's example, others in here, that it's not an exercise in futility, even though when the situation is dire, even though this man died, that it is worthwhile to at least try to change things that you see not to be the way it is for people living in liberty. How would you try to convince some young people out there?
Well, I would hold up what I said, I try to put it in context, right? Put it in context of what you think there's a man who could have gone to any other place in the world and made big money and so forth and be a big and so forth. But he gave that up, right? Because he believed in something. He came from the working class. He was committed, not just believed, but committed to that belief. He came from the working class and saw that experience, never forgot it. And so as he became educated, that education was a means to him. The aim was to reinsert himself in the working class experience and try to liberate, try to help in the liberation of working people from the drudgery that they found them beneath. So the first thing I would say is that educate yourself. But as you educate yourself, this is a particular goal in mind. But education is not just something that you must have, that you can use, and back to this and back to that. But your education is a means towards what? Empowering to be used towards help, to helping, to help, to empower the people from where you, whose lands you come from. So I think I would say that you must be educated. But you must be educated with a particular goal in mind. So if you're thinking today, go to school and get a degree to go and find work and go and some money. But you have to go to feed your family and so on and so forth. But your material condition would not improve even when you get a little office job and so on. Unless the material conditions of the entire working people are improved.
Let me ask you, I know that as part of Indian culture, that is part and parcel of what it is, but knowledge is not for itself, because I think what in line with the books of knowledge that whatever you wrote, you're not going to go around with this thing that, it's an effort that everybody has participated in, and, it's a accumulation of knowledge. And therefore, that viewpoint intrinsically leads you to say, well, you have a responsibility too.
in a sense, the village or the world has shaped you, and now you have a responsibility to help to better that world. And to me, and I know that to be an African perspective too, and Walter lived that. But coming back to the present, and I think it is a present, you're talking about liberation. Walter didn't shy away from the problem of violence as maybe necessary in certain situations to liberate oneself from oppressive conditions. He didn't shy away from that. He spoke explicitly to the situation many, many times. I live right now in a village called Guyana, in which four individuals from the same street where I'm living, the first street now, were part of a group that had been set to be arming themselves under Walter's guidance, or with, you know, they have been part of that group. They were beaten severely. It's interesting to see what has happened to these people. Some of them, you know, destroyed, their lives destroyed, become flotsam and jetsam. But it was a moment where Walter had felt the situation in Guyana had reached to such an extent, so I guess what he was trying to say is that he was prepared to go that route. Now, you have an analogous situation here. You come from Buxton. Here's a group of young people, I don't know, some individuals in Buxton, who are saying that the situation as today is possibly that same degree of dread, and therefore they need, or they justify them then, that we should have an armed revolution against the state. How do you, is there any connection between these two responses, the same response in two different times? Are there any lessons that we can eke out and pass on as to?
First of all, I don't think there's a connection. I mean, Rodney was part of the larger movement, and it was clear by 1974 that the government of the day had closed all doors to democratic peace and democratic change. The promulgation of the Declaration of Society basically said the People's National Congress Party was paramount to all institutions in the country as a whole. And that same thing, lessons were not going to become a reality. So therefore, it was the government of the day that had closed the doors on peaceful democratic change. So allied to that, of course, was the economic conditions of the people that have been constant from the time of colonialism right to the Burnham period and so forth. And so the situation has reached a point where Rodney had inspired a mass movement, national movement. Now, I would not be able to speak to your question of Rodney and the Burnham period deciding to pick up arms. But I would see out of that kind of situation, leading to that kind of thinking. I'm not surprised as to that kind of thinking. Because the government was not prepared to really tolerate any form of dissent, any form of conversation whatsoever. Now I think the situation today is different. I have to say that. We are not under an out-and-out dictatorship. We live under an authoritarian system. We have not had a change of unchanging government, but the regime remains the same. We can see the state
ethos, especially
the government. But remains the state of state a life of its own. So the so-called democratic socialist PDP comes in and comes with an authoritarian political and economic framework and sits on
it and goes.
And so on. We have not had any political assassination under the PPP. You and I can sit down here on public television and talk about writing something we could not do 30 years ago. I'm saying that the state oppression continues, but it comes in different kinds. Our doors to people that are practicing. I would have absolutely no problem in publicly and privately sanctioning people picking up arms to defend the best, first and foremost. Because if the state is coordinating on you, you've got to defend yourself.
And even the liberal law defines that. The social contract, if the government breaks a social contract, there's no contract.
Yes, but
the only thing that state has been reached at this point.
No, I think that you see, one has to ask oneself, if you pick up arms in the context of this situation, where is that going to lead us? You see, if I'm talking about picking up arms, it was armed against the state, and there was no African and Indian people behind it. Now, if you talk about picking up arms against the state, which in time, if you're black, it means picking up arms against Indians.
Right.
And if you're Indian, it means picking up arms against Africans. Well, I don't think that's the direction in which you want to go. So I think one has to be creative within the struggle. Huh? So why do you know what I know? That black people in this country feel oppressed, are oppressed, are frustrated. They feel as though they don't have a state in a nation, in a society that they've built with a blood, with sweat, they sacrifice themselves. And they feel left out. And so therefore, must have a practical reaction to that. But I think leadership must be able to look at the situation. And that's why I said, if you go to root the violence, what is the end product? Is it going to be demanded of all of us? Are we going to remove the oppressive state and protect the working people, whether they're black or African? What are those things you think to? So I don't think what is happening in Boston, the kind of violence, I think I understand this, and the time where it comes from. But I would not put it within the context of resistance and political resistance. I wouldn't go that far with it. You see? I think what it does, most important for me, what's happening in Boston, is the way in which African people in general have sympathy for what is happening in Boston. And I think Indians and the Indian government need to take note of that. I don't think they understand that.
That's right. You see, this prevents a rabble and the words that I use, you know, to somehow make it seem as if it's an aberration. And it does not resonate. And I think it's something that, coming back to Walter's contribution in terms of not looking at surface phenomena, but looking at the systemic conditions that push up certain forces up there, needs to be revisited. And unfortunately, I want to tell you, David, this is not a government that wants to look at it that way, because I was on a program last night, and very brutally, the whole security system in this country, the whole security aspect for all people in Guyana, is not being forwarded in a system that can lead to stability. In fact, it's allowed to fester, you know, it's like Lanson Hughes said, about a soul festering. After a while, it'll explode, and that's what happens. A soul explodes ever so often, and then it's used as an excuse to say, you see what's happening, you know, you have to guard yourself against that. But I want to finish off, and we'll take some calls now, to talk about one last thing, that Walter Rodney uses a very specific phrase in terms of calling for an emancipation from this Babylon.
Yes.
Taking a phrase from the Rastafarian, who defines Babylon as all that the West has produced. And of course, what I want to say this, I've said it many times on the air, I'm in total agreement with the Rastafarian, and I'm in such awe of a set of grounded people. You know, those of us who went to university, you think you know Syrians are, you know? A set of grounded people could have pierced the miasma of what I call the whole Enlightenment project, which I was puzzled about. And see, to a great extent, a lot of the premises of what this we call the capitalist world, call it Babylon or what have you, that inherent within it are contradictions which will not lead to any kind of real emancipation. Like, you say not emancipate ourselves from it.
Yeah.
Is there something to that, and did he bring this out in his groundings?
Oh, definitely. And here is Walter taking the Rastafarian excuse, the Rastafarian expression, and taking that and accepting it in an African way, but also putting it within the context of poor people fighting for oppression. So that, again, Babylon was not just the white world. Babylon was Yusher and Boylam and everything, which are also the fight for independence. Who played a positive role as a practice of fighting party? But once the colonialists left, and they were given some degree of power within the society, they did not know how to manage that power. They did not manage that power in a way that empowered ordinary people. And so they were taking a Rastafarian expression, an African expression, and saying this expression is African. But it also comes out of a condition of poverty, a condition of oppression. And for all those in Walter, race and class, for Walter, you could not talk about race without class. And I want to say that to the viewers, that was constant in Walter Rodney.
You see, I'll end with this, but again, my position is that while within water, he was willing to transcend that, I think in terms of the whole notion to be now being grounded in the people, I think that's where that gap is, and I think it's part and parcel of why, after Walter's passing, you know, we in a sense have not gone forward from where he took us, from where he took us, and that to me is the greatest tragedy. So to me, it comes back to that we have to re-examine Walter's premises,
yeah,
as to, because if the strategy was that somehow you can fuse race and class into some kind of movement, he himself defined success as whether the people would be moved by that.
Yeah.
And if they haven't, we have to re-examine this too.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what Roar has been trying to do, but that's another issue. We're going to take some calls, but viewers, I want to give this announcement that Roar, in honor of this great man, whom everybody in Roar knows about, and we have talked about, but Rodney, throughout our history, you can't ignore his contribution. We have been working with David Hines and other individuals on this commemoration committee to put out this Rodney to the ultimate community. So we're going to have an event on West Coast at IFLOC that David and others have organized, a branding in IFLOC, IFLOC Community Center. This will be on Saturday. There is going to be a march on the public road from Cornelia Ida to IFLOC from 3 to 4, and then from 4 to 7 o'clock. Now there will be the groundings where David Hines, other members of the international and local committee will be there to really share their experiences with individuals from West Coast who might have been touched by Walter, might have heard of Walter, who might not have heard about him. But all of you should come out to our community center on Saturday at least for that event. And if you have the stamina to walk the 3 miles, please, please come out to the march, which will be from Camilo Alder to Alfred from 3 o'clock. So David, we take some calls. Mm-hmm. Hello, caller, good evening.
Hello, good evening to you, sir.
Yes, sir.
I think the absolute need for change.
But in terms of Dr. Rodney's work, are you in any way connected? Were you in any way affected? And is there any relevance from what you know? The Gandhi? Okay.
I did not read the whole.
Okay. I don't think we can break the racial arithmetic to such an extent that any new grouping can take power, wipe out the PDP and the PNC. We believe that the very best we can do at this juncture is to be able to carve out a space in the center where you can hold a balance. So if such a grouping can come together, work on a program that is related to issues that Walter identified in terms of the emancipation of people, in connecting your program in a realistic fashion to people, and most importantly, I believe, that if the leaders of such a movement can show the kind of integrity that Walter Rodney showed in terms of a commitment and putting everything on the line for what you talk about, and the people can reject that too, or the people can reject that, I believe the change can be made. David, you want to have a shot at it?
Yeah, I think that's one carry up to live and learn and be connected.